Welcome back. In the last video, we talked about, at a high level, the generic architecture evolution over the last few years. We started with talking about a web application. After that, we talked about web services. We talked about SOAP and REST web services. And after that, we went into the world of microservices and the cloud with Docker and Kubernetes. And starting this video, let's deep dive into each of these individual worlds. We will start with different patterns and architectures which were used for developing web applications a decade back. In this video, let's dig into web application architectures. Now, whenever we are talking about a web application, the focus is on the front end. The focus is on delivering something out to the browser, right? So the view framework becomes really, really important. And typically, what I use to generate views in the Java EE world or the JEE world, as it was called then, the things which I used typically are JSP and servlet. Servlet is typically a Java piece of code, and JSP is like HTML enhanced with a few tags. And you can use things like JSTL or things like direct Java code called scriptlets to write your views. Now, let's start with looking at the architecture of these two. What we started off first with was something called Model 1 architecture. So, what we are going to talk about now is something called a Model 1 architecture, where from the browser, so where does the request originate from to a web application? It starts from the browser, right? So, in the Model 1 architecture, there were no servlets. All that they were JSPs. So you have multiple JSPs, and from the browser you directly redirect to the JSPs. So you'll put the URLs to the JSPs in your views, and that's what would be hit. And from the JSP, you'd be able to talk to a model, maybe call a database, get your data, and do all the stuff you would want. So in this architecture, as you can see, it's very, very simple, but it can get very, very complex very, very soon. Why? Because all the logic, all business logic, all view logic, everything is present in one place. What is that place? That place is going to be your JSPs. They contain typically what is present in your servlets, what is typically present in your front controllers, and all that stuff goes into your JSPs, and this does not scale. So to build large applications in Model 1 architecture is almost impossible. And that's where we switched to a Model 2 architecture. In the Model 2 architecture, what we do is we bring in another element which is called the servlets. So most of the web applications around the last 1 year, actually I should say in the 2 decades ago to 1 decade ago time frame, were built using the Model 2 architecture. This is also called the Model View Controller architecture, MVC architecture. So from the browser, the request goes down to a servlet. So the request does not go to the JSP, it goes to a servlet, and the servlet then decides, okay, the browser wants to do something, let's call it the servlet one, and then it says, okay, go to a view or a JSP. So it's, let's say it sends it to a view, it gets the response back and sends it back to the browser. Actually, I forgot something which is important in here, which is a model. So model is where your business logic is present. So what the servlet does is actually it talks to the model. I mean, it talks to your business logic, gets the data ready, and then sends it out to the view. So it servlet also makes the model available to the view so that the view can use the model and generate a dynamic view. And that content goes back to the browser. So this is what is typically called a Model 2 architecture. There is also a modified version of the Model 2 architecture, which was very, very popular. We'll get into the frameworks very soon. Let's try and get the architecture right before we actually get into the frameworks which were used at that particular point in time. So we start from the browser as usual. However, the request from the browser first goes to something called a front controller. This is also called a front controller pattern, where all requests would first go to a front controller pattern. In the Model 2, you might have servlet 2, servlet 3, and so on and so forth. So the requests actually go to multiple servlets directly. From the browser, you would hit multiple servlets directly. But in the modified Model 2 architecture, always you would go to something called a friend controller. In Spring MVC, this friend controller is what is called a dispatcher servlet. So the friend controller looks at the request and it identifies what is the right controller to handle that. So it says, okay, this is the controller which is right controller to handle that. So the controller one, and it sends the request out to the controller one, which would talk to the business logic, do whatever it needs to do, and then it would actually redirect out to a view. So the whole thing would actually be using a front controller, a controller, modal, and a view. The great thing about having a front controller is that all the common logic can go into a friend controller. For example, if you want to make sure that you check whether the user is authenticated or authorized, whether there is a proper cookie in the request, all that kind of stuff can be done in the friend controller. So it can just look at the URL and also decide which controller to show. It can also decide which view to show and all that kind of fun stuff. So friend controller adds in a lot of value in the Model 2 modified architecture, and that's what we have been looking until now. Model 1, Model 2, Model 2 modified. Typically, when we started out with the JSP servlets, the most popular architecture was the Model 2 architecture. I mean, the initial applications used Model 1, but it did not survive the test of time. And for most amount of time, we were using either the Model 2 or the modified Model 2. So frameworks like Struts and also Spring MVC, they support the Model 2 modified architecture. So they all have a friend controller which takes the request and then redirects the request to the appropriate controller or the view. Now, that's kind of the popular frameworks. Other than these frameworks, there were also a couple of other frameworks which were popular, which were Vadin. Also, JSF was popular for quite some time, Java Server Faces, and also Spring Boot evolved over a period of time. So we were developing applications with Spring MVC for a long time, and slowly Spring MVC came in as microservices evolved, and it became much more easier. I mean, it became very, very important that we are able to develop applications quickly. So Spring Boot provided that opportunity. So Spring Boot, as soon as it sees something on the class path, a framework on the class path, it would auto-configure it. So you'd not need to provide all the configuration around a dispatcher servlet or things like that. So that's kind of the important frameworks that were used at around this time period. We'll not talk about EJBs because EJBs is more the business layer part of it, and EJBs like made transaction management and all that stuff easy. But with the evolution of the Spring framework, EJBs became quickly outdated, and most of the transaction management, even on the distributed side, became the responsibility of the business layer, which was typically built around the Spring framework. Now, if you look at the entire application, typically it was built using a layered architecture. So you had a web layer where all this stuff is present, and then you have a business layer where all the business logic goes into, and then you had a data layer where all the data base connection. So the data layer is responsible for talking to a database. You'll also have typically an integration layer. So if you'd want to talk to an external web service, or if you'd want to actually talk to external queue, any of that kind of stuff would go through the integration layer. So this is how we developed application. Whatever we saw, Model 1, Model 2, Model 2 modified, are what are the architectures in the web layer. On the business layer, we started with EJBs, as we talked earlier. The important thing in the business layer is to manage transactions and stuff like that. So we started with EJB, and quickly we evolved out to Spring framework. So for a long time, EJBs were actually playing were the favored option. EJBs went through multiple cycles, EJB 1, 2, 3, I don't remember if there was an EJB 4, but by that time, I think Spring framework was pretty famous, and business layer, transaction management, and all that stuff was taken care of by the Spring framework. Now, the data layer part of it, like how do we talk to the database? Typically, we started with JDBC, I mean Java Database Connectivity. Then we evolved to Spring JDBC. After that, we went into the world of MyBatis, or iBatis as it was called then. With Spring JDBC, like removed all the exception handling and everything that is needed around your JDBC code. With MyBatis, it made it very, very easy to take the data, like execute a query, get the data, and put it into a bin. So for MyBatis, the inputs are what is the query, what is the bin. And once you do that, you do not really need to write code to map the output of the query to a bin. And quickly, we evolved out to JPA. So Java Persistence API, this enables to map. Actually, before JPA was your Hibernate, but JPA became the standard for how you do the entity relationship mapping. So you'd map your Java bean. So let's say you have a course class and you'd want to map it to a database table called course. So you can do that kind of mapping using JPA, and JPA would take care of generating all the queries. If you'd want to update the course table, or if you'd want to delete a row, if you'd want to add a row, all that kind of stuff you can do with JPA without writing a lot of queries. So that's kind of the high level Java web application patterns, architecture, and also the frameworks. Let's look at a few more important patterns which were really useful. So we had multiple layers in here, and if you had to implement something across these layers, the typical pattern which was used was AOP, aspect oriented programming. Typically, aspect oriented programming is used to implement cross-cutting concerns. Examples of cross-cutting concerns include logging. So if I want to do logging, so if I want to log every call across all the multiple layers, then I can use AOP, intercept the calls, and log them. So that's one important pattern which was very, very popular. The other one is also something called a facade pattern, especially with EJBs. The business layer was distributed in the sense that the web layer was on one system, the business layer can be on another system. So you don't want multiple calls to go from the web layer to the business layer, because that would be slow. And a facade typically does all the coordination with all the business components, gets the data, and returns the entire result set back to the web. So the facade is like in the business layer, instead of making multiple calls between web and business, what we do is we have a facade. So the business layer offers a facade, and it would make multiple calls to the data layer or any other business components that need to be there, and it would return one single set of interface out to the web layer, which the web layer makes use of and takes the data back. The other important pattern which came up obviously because of the Spring framework was the dependency injection part, right? So we have multiple layers. Each layer is dependent on the other. And typically when we started with developing our web applications, unit testing was almost impossible, because this web layer would say, a class in the web layer, controller in the web layer would say, is equal to new business. And then they are tightly coupled to each other. Spring framework made it very, very easy to actually make them loosely coupled. And after that, we started writing unit tests using mocks, making sure that we'd be able to test the individual components in each of these layers. So that's, I guess, some of the important things around the Java web application patterns and architectures. The idea was not to cover everything, but was to give a big picture around what happened when we were building web applications with Java in, let's say, the 2000s, like around 1995 to 2010. Was that the time frame? Something around that, right? So that's right about the time frame where we were building a lot of web applications using JSPs, servlets, struts, Spring MVC, and all that stuff. And this was just to give you a quick overview of all that fun stuff. This is the second video in our series of videos talking about the evolution of Java architectures. In this video, we talked about Java web application architecture, and hopefully in the next one, I would see you with web services. So we'll talk about web services, SOAP, and REST. And over the period of next few videos, we would probably get into microservices, cloud, and full stack as well. I hope you are liking this approach of creating videos where you would visually see me draw stuff. If you like this approach, make sure that you like the video and also subscribe to this. One of the frequently asked questions for us is, how do I become a full stack developer? How do I become a microservices developer? How do I learn the cloud? How do I become an expert on AWS? The amazing thing is we have learning paths built for each of these, and these learning paths contain what are the skills you would need, what is the learning path, how can you start, what can you do next, what can you do everything to achieve your goal, and also these learning paths contain videos and course recommendations with these things. You can find a link to these learning paths in the description of this particular video, and you can check out whichever learning path you'd want. For example, the learning path 05 is the one which makes you an expert on AWS. So it has the recommended skills, it has the prerequisite skills, it has the recommended course path, and also it has recommended preview courses. These are free courses you can do, and also it has links to the other learning paths as well. We recommend you to make the best use of these learning paths to make sure that you stay ahead of the curve. Keep learning in 28 minutes. Until the next video, bye-bye.